A new documentary puts the spotlight on survivors of state-sponsored atrocities committed during martial law. Here's a quick look at 11,103.
Yung namasakir kami, doon banda yung mga tao. Tapos yung tumira sila doon, yung dalawang anak ko, yun ang nadali.
Sa ano?
Yung anak ko na si Cecil, dito siya, ginaganon ko na lang siya kasi para talagang hindi siya maka, para hindi siya maka, ano, maka, imik. Basta umiyak ka na lang. Pero parang inubos ko na lahat dito eh. Para iniwan ko na dito, pati dugo namin lahat nandito na, nakatanim na dito. Kaya sabi nung anak ng kapitan, hindi talagang hindi namin pagbili yung lupo na yan man lang kasi ano, binayaran ang dugo.
Well, joining us now are the film's directors and writers, Jeanette Ifirong and Mike Alcazarin, and producer Kara Magsanok Alekpala. Guys, welcome to the program. Thanks for joining us today. Really appreciate you coming to the show.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kara.
All right, so since we are kind of squeezed into one frame here, I'm going to ask you questions one by one. I'm going to start off with Kara first. Kara, in 1997, you produced a film called Batas Militar that was decades ago. And now you're coming out with this new film, 11,103. The two films, one subject but different presentations. Tell us the reason behind, first of all, why you chose to produce another film about martial law and why the difference in presentation this time?
Well, obviously, after 25 years, people have forgotten the lessons of martial law. We were always told when we did the first one, Batas Militar, that the price of democracy is eternal vigilance. It's so easy, it's a no-brainer. You think people will not forget. You think that what happened, the ill-gotten wealth and all that was so outrageous, but actually people forget. So we're doing this again. But we decided that this time, unlike any other documentary we've done besides Batas Militar, we will focus on the victims. I don't even want to call them victims, I'm sorry. The heroes, survivors, and the martyrs, because they will form the best emotional connection with the audience and they can deliver the message more effectively for us. They really embody the horrors of martial law. Their lives have been altered, destroyed, interrupted. And you still feel the effects of their trauma till today. It recurs now and then, even to the next generation. So, you know, theirs is very truthful and factual and very personal. There are a lot of stories and they're dying out right now. There's a race for time to have all these stories compiled and be really scattered so everybody knows what really happened. Mm-hmm. We must unite behind a common truth. So that's why we did it this way. We took another tack and we tried to appeal to the young. We put animation in the film this time.
I saw snippets of it and really it goes beyond the numbers. The past years, people have been talking about the numbers. It's now time to see the faces behind those numbers. I'm gonna go to Jeanette Ifirong now. Jeanette, recently, Senator Jingoy Estrada said that with a 31 million vote mandate, he thinks that the majority of the people do not believe in the atrocities and the abuses that happened during martial law anymore. What is the message of this film to this so-called majority that the senator speaks of?
That's exactly why we did this, because like it or not, the effort to revise history has been successful. So our message is, these people that we're featuring in the film, watch it, they're unmistakably telling the truth. Mm. You can't deny it, you can see it. Mm. And what we hope is that we reach enough people, change enough hearts to make a difference.
Mike, let me go to you now. When you direct a film, when you're right there in the middle of directing that film, what is the vision of that person watching the film? Who is that person that you want to touch, that you want this film to really reach out to and speak to?
From the get-go, we knew that we were going to appeal to the next generation. That's why, like Kara mentioned, even the visual style of using animation and we have to be cognizant of our new viewership, which, you know, the next gen with their 3-second attention span. We had to appeal, and even the use of the documentary as retelling the martial law story had to be repackaged. That's why we chose to focus on the human stories, on putting a face to the figure, making humanizing the statistics, so it will appeal. We needed to tell the story so it will appeal more to the emotion, because people are just spewing out their facts and pitting the human cost versus how many bridges we're building. So the Marcos administration was building, or the kilometers of roads that he was putting up, that came at a human cost. So that was our main focus, to focus on the survivors, or those who were waylaid, were in no man's land, and even those who really fought for the restoration of our democracy.
Just a follow-up to that, Mike, you know what they've been saying, at least some people, when you talk about martial law, instead of never again, they're saying, let's move on. And it's not just the statement that they're saying. And when you talk about the younger generation now, it seems to be a way of life as well. You're right about the attention span. So what is it in this film that will make them stay put and really listen and feel the stories of these survivors and these heroes, as Kara mentioned? Go ahead, Mike.
In the beginning, this was supposed to be a commemorative film, a film about those who fought against the dictatorship. But now, with the things happening, and of course, what Jeanette said, that the restoration of the Marcoses, it's more of a warning now. It's telling that we obviously didn't learn our lesson. So it's now more important to listen to what happened before. Moving on doesn't mean burying the past. Like I posted a few seconds ago, you cannot vote history out. History is there for you to improve on. We need to evolve as a democracy, and obviously that didn't happen. And this story hopes to bring back to the basic respect of human rights, and that should be a starting point. We can't discuss figures and facts and statistics. We can discuss that to death, but I'm sorry, pardon that pun, but we need to discuss more of the human cost. And hopefully that gets through the new generation, the people who will be seeing or hearing these stories for the first time.
Let me go back to Kara now. Kara, as you went deeper into the faces, the stories, the families that were broken behind those numbers, what do you know now for sure that you didn't know previously when you produced Batas Militar in 1997?
I didn't realize how strong these survivors were. It's amazing how strong their spirit has become despite what they've been through. So when we interview them, we are more outraged than they are. They're the ones reassuring us. They're the ones telling us we have to keep up the fight. That spirit is really amazing. I have the greatest respect for them. And their patriotism is, wow, you know, unequaled. And we spoke to the everyday man. We didn't really interview the prominent personalities that you normally see in other documentaries. So the martial survivor is someone else, something else, a different kind of patriot.
Jeanette, let me go back to you. Why was it important for you to be part of this film? And what made it difficult for you as well to be part of it?
Difficult. That's funny. It's difficult to work when you're always angry. So that was kind of where the team was while we were working on the documentary. But important to get truth out there. It's important to keep fighting the lies, to keep fighting the trolls. I said during the premiere that we took for granted that, that history was going to get it right. Obviously, it didn't. So that's why it's important to keep telling these stories, to keep fighting for the truth.
Here's the thing, though. Let me go to Mike now. We can only tell the stories as much as we want to, as many times as we want to. But without people who would want to listen, who are eager enough to learn, our stories, your stories, might just fall on deaf ears. What makes you optimistic that there are people who are eager and willing to learn about the past?
I'm buoyed also by the fact, and then I have to go back to the past elections, there is that spark of hope that people will listen. I hang on to that hope. I hope that people are not too down on themselves, because there are people, no matter how small our group is, or for that matter, other organizations that are trying to keep the stories alive. My friend said, he said that this was really both a sprint relay, passing the baton, and also marathon. So right now, what our work is like a sprint, and trying to pass on the baton of telling these stories to the younger generation. I hope somebody gets the baton or doesn't drop the baton, and then that younger person will run a marathon, because we have to be realistic too. It's going to be a tough climb back to retelling the truth. But I will rely on that hope from the past experience in the elections of the youth who came out in droves.
Kara, there's remembrance and then there's relevance. How does 11,103, how does this film make these memories relevant?
I think the past is something, you know, when you have any family has a history, and you want to know what happened in the past. You want to know what something about your grandmother, your grandfather, what they were like, how would they behave. And so you carry that with you. If you don't know anything about your grandparents or the grandparents of your grandparents, you have no heritage, you have no story, you're lost. You have no anchor. You have a hard time moving forward. You don't know who you are. You need all these elements, especially your heritage, you know, your past. To really complete who you are and to know and define your destiny. So we need this as a nation. We need all these collective stories. There aren't enough out there. We need all these stories to be out there. We need everyone to help the stories go out. That's why one of our call to actions is, if you know a survivor, please have them document the story. If they're not ready, just have them put it in pen and paper, keep it, maybe share it another time. And if you have a nice cell phone or even an ugly cell phone, just document the story. It sounds so simple, but all these stories matter. We have to build the family album of the nation. There's not enough. The past will always be relevant, especially in this case. I mean, we haven't even learned, so we always have to look back.
And with that, I'm going to go to Jeanette now. Jeanette, you've talked to so many people. You've collated a lot of these stories that Kara mentioned. Aside from being survivors, aside from being heroes, what's the common denominator between and among these people that you talked to and captured on film?
Don't know if there's a it's a lot of people. It's not just 11,000 plus, right? Mm-hmm. But I think they're just, most of these people are just ordinary people. They were just trying to live their lives during martial law. And then for some reason got caught in the crossfire. And then there's the small percentage who were actually out there fighting. So these people, like you said, they're heroes. And the common denominator among those people is their love for the country. Mm. Their patriotism, as Kara said. Mm.
And they're patriots who would do it all over again.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. Mm.
This film, we've been talking about it. People have been learning about it. They have a chance to watch it. Kara, tell us when and where.
Yeah, we invite you tonight at 6 p.m. at the Bantayag ng Mga Bayani to watch the film. It's free for all. Please bring your own umbrella in case it rains, your own food and water. But if you stay tuned on our pages, our social media pages, 11103 Film on Facebook, Instagram, we even have TikTok, you will see the schedules because they're simultaneous premieres all over the country and other screenings here and even in the U.S.
Mm. Please be there. Kalikpala. Jeanette Furong, Mike Alcazarin, thank you so much for being with us today. Really appreciate it. And good luck. Congratulations. Job well done. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Carmina.
Thank you, Carmina.
Thanks a lot.